This is joint work with Mike Jordan, and it's about trying to understand some questions at the interface or intersection of statistics and computation. And it's motivated by the following sort of setup that shows up in many other domains as well. And it's where you are an advertiser and you wish to participate in an auction in an ad exchange. So you have some user that visits some website, and you have some maybe information about this user, and based on what he or she may have searched for or the sorts of information that he or she seeks online, you can place a bid on whether or not you want to advertise your product in some panel somewhere. And in these ad auctions, the decisions that you need to make, the amount that you're willing to pay to place your ad, is guided by a whole ton of information that you have about users, typically, but not very much time to make those decisions. So the sort of setup is a lot of data to try to address, to try and figure out at what level you want to bid, but very little time to make these decisions, frequently on the order of milliseconds or even less. And this is somehow different from the kinds of constraints that we have in statistical estimation theory. The sorts of constraints we typically think about are the amount of data. And so in classical statistical analysis, the notion of a minimax estimator, a minimax analysis in general, is what's central to estimation theory. Trying to compute the best sorts of estimators or consider the best sorts of estimators that operate given a fixed amount of data, rather than trying to take into account time are the sorts of constraints that people have looked at. So again, to repeat that, because it wasn't clear. Typically, folks have considered in classical statistical analysis, the amount of data is the key constraint, and what's the best estimation performance you can obtain given, given a small amount of data. But in the sorts of problems that I just described, time is the key bottleneck, and data is typically plentiful. So what's the best decision that you can make in terms of risk in a bounded amount of time is the sort of question that we want to understand to be able to address, questions like this. Okay? So we need some informed way in minimax analysis to be able to incorporate time constraints. And so a simple experiment to try to understand, thrown some toy numbers in here to try and understand how we might try and think about this problem, right? So consider a typical scenario where you are given 5,000 data points. Think of these data points as being independent. And you run your computer for an hour, and you get a risk of 0.03. Now you're given 500,000 data points. You run your computer for 20 days to solve the same estimation problem on the same inference task, and you get a risk of 0.0003, much smaller risk. But suppose I tell you that I'm happy with a risk of 0.03, and I give you 500,000 data points. What should your response be? This is, again, a toy version of the setup that we had before, where you have a ton of data, and you want to make decisions in a bounded amount of time. So you're happy with a risk of 0.03, but you have a lot of data. So it should be clear, at least if the data are exchangeable or IID, that you shouldn't need to run your computer for more than an hour, right? Because I can just take a subsample of 5,000, run my computer for an hour, and get a risk of 0.03, if the data are homogeneous or IID in general. Why might this be reasonable? Why might I be happy with a risk of 0.03 in many settings? This is reasonable because in many cases, I may not care about such small improvements in risk from, say, 0.03 to something like that. In many other settings, statistical models are only approximations to reality. They aren't reality. So when I'm trying to estimate parameters, accuracies of this type are typically more than sufficient to make informed decisions. And so is it possible for more data to lead to less computation? And so let me explain what I mean. In this sort of setup, in this toy setup, it should be clear that in this case, you should never need to run your computer for more than an hour, right? You can just take 5,000 points, run your algorithm for an hour, and you're done. But is it possible that using 10,000 points or 20,000 points or 100,000 points, You can obtain the same risk, so you don't improve your risk, but with the payoff being that you can reduce the amount of computation required. You should certainly not have increasing computation if the desired risk is fixed. But can you reduce computation as you have more and more data? And this is somehow a tension between computer science at some level and statistics at some other level. In numerical computation specifically, these sorts of analyses that we conduct are on trade-offs between runtime and error. And runtime typically quantified in, say, iterative algorithms via the number of iterations. So I, you know, run an algorithm with a certain number of iterations, 50 iterations versus 100 iterations. How does my error decay as a function of the number of iterations? This is the typical kind of analysis or thinking in numerical computation. In statistics, the traditional way of thinking about things is on the trade-off between amount of data and the best error you can obtain, or the error that you can obtain with a specific inference algorithm. So what are trade-offs in this 2D axis? So as I get more and more data, at what rate does the risk decrease of the optimal estimator or of a given specific estimator? Right? But we don't typically think of trade-offs in this setting, where I fix the desired risk or fix the desired accuracy and ask, how can I trade off amount of data for computation? Certainly for a fixed desired risk, you need a minimum amount of data to be able to obtain that risk. But beyond that minimum level, can I use extra data to reduce computation? And so that's the space in which we'll talk about things in this talk. And so the first few slides are just about what we can hope to obtain from trying to understand time data trade-offs at a fairly general level. What can you possibly obtain? What are the sorts of statements you can make given the current state of the art in statistics, given the current state of the art in computer science? And then I'll move on to a very simple statistical inference problem and talk about how convex optimization, and specifically the notion of convex relaxation, can help you obtain these sorts of time data trade-offs. Okay? So I'm going to view inference procedures as points in this plot. So by that I mean I'm going to consider an inference problem abstractly stated. Think of it, you know, think of a parameter estimation problem, perhaps, where you fix the desired risk, fix the desired accuracy to which you want to solve your problem. And you view inference procedures as points in this plot. So you have number of samples on one axis, runtime on the other axis, and you hope to be able to obtain plots like this, where as you have more and more data, you reduce runtime with the idea that you still obtain the same fixed risk. Okay? Now, anytime you have a plot that attempts to understand trade-offs, the first question you should ask is, what do vertical lines in this plot mean, and what do horizontal lines in this plot mean? So what does a vertical line in this plot mean? A vertical line in this plot means, to obtain my fixed risk, what is the smallest amount of data that I need independent of computational considerations? What is the minimum amount of data required to obtain a desired accuracy estimate? And this is relatively well understood. In many domains, we understand many max risk bounds in statistics for many, many classes of problems. There are still interesting open questions here, but this is a rich and well-developed field. The complementary question you can ask is on horizontal lines. What is the minimum amount of computation required given access to an unbounded amount of data to obtain your fixed risk? And of course, in this sort of setup, you do need to take into account the computation required, you know, access data and even basic pre-processing, everything. But you're given, in principle, access to an unbounded amount of data, and what's the minimum amount of time, a minimum number of operations required to obtain your fixed risk. This, even in many other settings in computer science, is not as well understood. This is, you know, the central open question in computer science and complexity theory specifically. And it depends on various things. It depends on the computational model. For instance, the Turing model may or may not be the most appropriate model if you're thinking about numerical computation, if you're thinking about solving a sequence of linear systems, perhaps. You might want different atomic blocks, atomic units of computation, if you want to think about lower bounds in computation here. But in any case, this is, on the whole, much less well understood than vertical plots like this, than vertical lines like this. But our hope is to try and understand somehow trade-offs given, you know, what the lay of the land is in each of these fields. And so some very, very basic things you can say in the abstract in general are that as I give you more and more data, you need some mechanism to be able to back off to a weaker algorithm. If you use the same algorithm with this many data points as you would with this many data points, you are going to increase in runtime, and you're going to obtain a decrease in risk. If you use the same algorithm on more data points versus less. So what you need, as you're given more and more data, is some mechanism to be able to back off to simpler algorithms, with the idea that if I can process a larger data set more coarsely, I might still be able to obtain the same desired risk, but that I might be able to do so with less computation. So we really need some mechanism for algorithm weakening. It is also the case that if I give you lots and lots and lots of data and you live in a setting where access to data or even touching each data point has a cost associated with it, at some stage you will need to throw away data. And so you should expect to see plots that look like this. Now, of course, this depends on the specific computational model that you have. It depends on the specific space of algorithms that you consider, and we'll see examples of this too in a few slides. And the last thing is that we'll trade off runtime upper bounds. Given that obtaining lower bounds in terms of computational complexity are difficult, what I'll talk about are trade-offs of the following kind. As you give me more data, I'll give you a different algorithm that has a smaller worst-case runtime upper bound. So it'll have a smaller upper bound rather than trading off lower bounds. This is very different from the sorts of trade-offs you see in other domains, like in physics, or other settings where you trade off lower bounds, where you talk about conservation laws and so on. So this will be a trade-off involving upper bounds. Okay. Yeah. So some of these worst-case upper bounds for these sorts of algorithms I'll talk about are tight. So there will be instances of problems that attain those upper bounds. It is, in general, not clear if the specific instances that arise in statistical estimation meet those upper bounds. So, I mean, there is a lot of interesting questions to ask here, even at the level of phrasing the right kind of question. But I think it is still reasonable to talk about trying to use weaker algorithms, because we do recognize on a computer, at least, if I can run a simpler algorithm, it will run much faster. And so it is reasonable to at least attempt to talk about this. Okay. And so this is all, you know, these are all things I said sort of in the abstract about a generic estimation problem, if you will. But getting to the specifics, the simplest possible estimation problem that I could think of when we started working on this was the normal means problem. And this is the problem where you have a signal corrupted by Gaussian noise, and the signal comes from a known set. So the signal lives in p-dimensional space, and it comes from a set that's known to me. The specific point itself is unknown, but this set is known. And I observe n IID samples from this process. So n samples of normally or Gaussian corruptions of x star. Okay. And it's clear that the sample mean is a sufficient statistic, and a natural estimator that you can write down is to take the sample mean and project it onto the signal set S. Right? This is, in some sense, the most natural thing you could do. Now, this frequently turns out to be difficult depending on the kinds of signal sets you care about. For instance, signal sets that are based on sparse models are typically difficult to project onto. Signal sets that have some sparsity structure in them, as well as structure involving rank constraints, which are also common in many applications, are very, very difficult to project onto directly. And so a natural thing to try to do is to look at convex relaxations, where you project onto some convex set that I'll assume is a superset of your signal set S. Okay? And this is very much in the spirit of what has been going on over the last 10, 15, 20 years in machine learning and statistics and related fields, where we shrink onto convex sets for computational tractability. So this goes back to, you know, shrinkage estimation statistic goes back all the way to the late 50s and early 60s. But especially beginning with the work of Donahoe and Johnstone, shrinking or projecting onto convex sets for purposes of computational tractability is a very nice thing to do for many, many reasons. And there are many interesting surprises, many interesting phenomena that occur in high dimensions. By that, I mean large P. So you have signals living in very high dimensions, P. And more recently, shrinking not just onto the L1 ball, as in what Donahoe and Johnstone did, but shrinking onto other sorts of convex sets is also something that's very popular. It's a very common thing to do. So this idea of replacing complicated-looking sets by convex sets for reasons of computational tractability is something that's very much in the spirit of what's been going on over the last few years in statistics, in computer science, or in signal processing and in machine learning. Okay, so to try and understand the performance of this estimator, we need to have two definitions to be able to state the main theorem. The first one is a definition on the computational side, or on the convex geometry side. And it involves the cone of feasible directions of a convex set. So if I have a point x star in a convex set, what are the set of directions that I can go to locally where I still remain in the convex set? And that's, so this is a toy example of what I just had. X star is a point in a complicated looking set. I take a convex relaxation of S, the signal set, and the set of directions I can go into are all these directions. This is the cone of feasible directions. That's on the computational side or on the convex optimization side. On the statistical side, the key concept that we need to be able to talk about performance of that estimator that I just wrote down is the Gaussian complexity. I put a squared in here because there's a square. But it's defined as follows. Given a cone T, the Gaussian complexity of the cone is the soup over all normalized vectors of the, in the cone of the inner product between your Gaussian random noise and this vector in the cone with the square. The expectation is with respect to this Gaussian. So again, just two basic concepts, one from convex geometry and one from machine learning. And this notion of Gaussian complexity also has other names. If you look at different literature, it's called the Gaussian width in some cases as well. And the risk of that estimator, x hat n of c, recall that x hat n was the estimator given, you know, formed by taking n samples, taking the sample mean, and projecting onto the convex set c, is given as follows. It's sigma squared over n times the Gaussian complexity of the cone of feasible directions at x star into c. So if the cone is very narrow, the Gaussian complexity is small, and you get a tighter error bound, which makes sense. If you have no constraints at all, so the cone is all of Rp, then this quantity will be very large, and you get P, in fact. If, in fact, you're not doing any projection, you would get P. And that's exactly the risk of the sample mean. Okay. It's a straightforward, very simple result to prove. You can generalize it to the cases where you have non-Gaussian noise. You can obtain better sorts of bias variance trade-offs, but those are lower-level details. The high-level idea is that the Gaussian complexity of this cone of feasible directions is what controls the risk of your estimate. Okay. All right, so what this means, going back to the philosophy that we had right at the beginning of the talk, is that if you fix the desired risk, what sorts of statements can you make? So if we fix the desired risk to be, say, 1, then the number of samples that you need by reordering these terms has to be lower bounded by just this quantity, right? So if I have n greater than this quantity, So sigma squared times the Gaussian complexity, then I'm guaranteed to obtain an estimator with a risk of at most 1. So this less than or equal to 1, and then just rearrange terms. And so what this means for time data trade-offs is that if I give you a very, very large amount of data n, so n is a big, big number, I can use as large a convex set as possible so that this time sigma squared is still less than or equal to n. Right? So this quantity, recall, is monotonic in the convex set C. Because as C becomes bigger, the cone of feasible directions becomes bigger, and the Gaussian complexity becomes bigger. Okay, so if I give you a very large n, you can use as large a C as is feasible, so that sigma squared times this complexity involving C is less than or equal to n. And again, we can show that in pictures. You have a complicated looking signal set. You take one convex relaxation of it, which is C given by this gray area. You can take a relaxation of it given by C prime. The cones of feasible directions expand, and the Gaussian complexities expand. So if I can now prove for you or show you a mechanism whereby larger convex sets C are easier to project onto than smaller ones, then we are done, right? If I have a large amount of data n, I can use a very large convex set. And if I can show for you a mechanism where projecting onto a larger set is easier computationally than projecting onto a smaller one, then we do obtain time data trade-offs, right? As you have more and more data, take a larger and larger convex set, project onto easier and easier sets computationally, and you'll obtain a weaker and weaker estimation algorithm. Okay? And so this is something that is the result of a ton of really beautiful work in the convex optimization literature. This idea that if I have structured signal sets, I'm going to say algebraic within quotes, that the convex hull of S can be approximated in a very nice way via a sequence of convex sets. And what's interesting about this family of approximations is that it's ordered not just by approximation quality, but also by computational complexity. So that projecting onto C1 is easier than projecting onto C2, is easier than projecting onto C3, and so forth. And this is this idea has received a lot of attention even in the computer science community, because it's one of the most popular ways to design approximation algorithms for hard problems. These approximations can be polyhedral approximations, so then you live in the domain of linear programming. They can be semi-definite approximations, in which case you'd live in the domain of semi-definite programming, and so on and so forth. And these are all the names associated with these ideas. And just as a small detour, what's central in obtaining these sorts of approximations that are ordered both by approximation quality as well as by computational complexity is this notion of lift and project. So if there's one takeaway that you take from this talk, from the optimization side of things, it's this idea that I'm going to represent a convex set in p-dimensional space as the projection of a set in a space that's larger than p dimensions. And as the lifting dimension, the larger dimension space becomes bigger and bigger, I obtain better and better approximations to my original set in p dimensional space, but I also have to pay a greater and greater cost computationally. And so this idea of lift and project is what is central to obtaining these hierarchies of relaxation. So the point I wish to make here is that in general, it is not the case that projecting onto a larger convex set is easier than projecting onto a smaller one. But what is true is that projecting onto a very specific family of larger and larger convex sets, specifically based on these lift and project ideas, does in fact give you this ordering in terms of computation complexity as well as in terms of approximation quality. So these are very specially designed convex sets onto which projection is easier as you get larger and larger sets. Okay. At this stage, I meant to mention this previously, but I think this is the most appropriate stage to mention a ton of previous work on computational and statistical trade-offs. A lot of this was even done in the setting of binary classifier learning as opposed to the normal denoising problem that I've been talking about. It goes back all the way to early work in the late 1990s. There was this term called computational sample complexity used by some folks in CS theory. More recently in machine learning, Shai Shalev Schwartz and Nadi Cerebro and their colleagues have done a bunch of interesting work in the setting of binary classifier learning. One sort of general point of contrast with all these papers versus what I'll talk about in the coming slides is that in these papers, you need a ton of extra data to be able to back off to simpler algorithms. And what we'll see in the examples coming up is that in the denoising problem, this is very much a feature of the denoising problem, is that you just need a modest amount of extra data to be able to back off to simpler algorithms. Some other work that I'd like to point out is in sparse PCA and related problems involving clustering and network inference. Martin Wainwright and a student, Arash Amini, did some interesting work here. There's very recent, more interesting work by Philippe Rigolet and a student on trying to obtain lower bounds in the case of sparse PCA, just that relates to the question that was just brought up. And there's also interesting work by Alec Agarwal and Peter Bartlett and John Ducci on Oracle inequalities for model selection that incorporate time constraints as well as sample constraints. But in sort of general high-level contrast to all these previous pieces of work, our work, I think, emphasizes this notion of algorithm weakening, the idea that you really need a mechanism to back off to simpler algorithms as you have more and more data, and that convex relaxation is a very nice way to accomplish this algorithm weakening. It's sort of the only general principled approach I know of that allows you to do this in many, many different settings. And a lot of popular algorithms in machine learning these days are based on convex optimization. And so I think these ideas are potentially very useful in practice, too. Okay, so before we get to our specific examples, how do we calculate runtime? There are two operations involved in computing estimates based on the estimator I described. One is to compute the sample mean, so that's n data points times p. And then the next is the number of operations for projection, right? Projection onto the convex set C. Computing the sample mean increases as you give me more and more data because n increases as I have more data. But the number of operations for projection, because you're projecting onto a simpler set, decreases. And our hope is that this decrease is larger than this increase, and so you do actually obtain time data trade-offs. And this is something we'll see concretely in some examples. The next thing I want to point out is how do you estimate Gaussian complexity? There are very general methods to do this based on Dudley's integral formula involving covering numbers and so on. For the case of convex cones, the specific sense in which Gaussian complexity appears here, where I take normalized vectors in a cone and take the square, these sorts of covering number arguments tend not to be the sharpest tools to use. And so one can prove a more specific theorem for the case of convex cones, which goes as follows. If I have a convex cone T, where the dual of the cone has relative volume mu, so that's the fraction of the sphere that the dual of the cone covers, then the Gaussian squared complexity is given by this quantity. So let's see if it even makes sense at a sort of superficial high level, right? If I have a fatter and fatter cone T, its dual becomes thinner and thinner, so the relative volume of the dual becomes smaller and smaller, and so 1 over mu becomes larger, and so it all sort of goes in the right direction. So for a larger cone T, I will have that the Gaussian complexity grows, or at least this bound grows. And this is a proof based on Gaussian isoperimetry, where you don't need to look at all possible cones where the dual has relative volume mu. You only need to look at the spherical cone with dual having relative volume mu. And so that somehow is an extremal example exactly in the spirit of isoperimetric inequalities. And this is also something that we proved essentially this result in an earlier paper with Ben Reck, Pablo Perillo, and Alan Wilski. Okay, so getting to examples. The first example is one that's motivated conceptually by problems in collaborative filtering and in clustering, where the signal set S consists of rank one matrices made up of just plus or minus one. So outer products of plus minus one vectors. The best convex relaxation that you could use is the convex hull of S, This is called the cut polytope. And projecting onto this polytope, as far as we know, requires time that's super polynomial in P. If you could project onto this polytope in polynomial time, you'd be able to solve max cut, which is an NP-complete problem in polynomial time. But if in principle you could project onto this polytope, the number of samples that you need to obtain a risk 1 estimate is a constant times square root of P. If in fact you could project onto that polytope. A common relaxation of this polytope is what's called the elliptope. This is the relaxation used in the Gomans-Williamson approach to solving the max cut problem. This is a semi-definite relaxation. And this has runtime p to the 2.25. The best algorithms, the best general purpose algorithms require this sort of runtime to project onto the elliptope. The number of samples required in this case to obtain a risk 1 estimate is a different constant times square root p, where this constant is larger than this one. The final relaxation you could use is to project onto the nuclear norm ball. This is the convex hull of rank 1 matrices. The reason you might want to do this is because you recognize that the signal set is composed of rank 1 matrices, so projecting onto the convex hull of rank 1 matrices is a reasonable thing to try to do. And this has runtime based just on the SVD of p to the 1.5. Note that the signal lives in p-dimensional space, so it's a square root p by square root p-sized matrix. So that's the reason you have these strange-looking exponents. And if you did this, the number of samples required for risk 1 estimate is a different constant times square root p. And so just by increases in constant factors, you can back off to very, very simple algorithms. Okay? The next problem is actually something that Alex talked about. And our motivation here was actually based on banding estimators for covariance matrices, where a natural way to band based on the work of Peter Bickel and Lisa Lavina was to threshold all the entries away from the diagonal. And this is a reasonable approach if you have a good ordering for your random variables. But in cases where you don't have a good ordering, you'd have to adopt an approach like what Alex described. And a stylized version of the problem that I'll talk about is where M is a known tri-diagonal matrix, and the signal set is all possible shufflings of the rows and columns of M. And so you want to jointly estimate the covariance matrix and the ordering that gives you, that makes banding a reasonable thing to try to do. Again, the best possible convex relaxation you could write down requires time that's super polynomial, and this is the number of samples for a risk 1 estimate. You make the observation that every element of the signal set, because M is tri-diagonal, is a sparse matrix. And so you can use the L1 ball as a ball onto which you project, and the runtime in that case goes down drastically. And again, at the expense of just a constant factor increase in the amount of data. A third example where we also see a constant factor increase in the amount of data is where the signal set consists of all possible perfect matchings in the complete graph. This shows up in problems in network tomography and in network inference. Rich Baraniuk and others have done some interesting work involving these sorts of structures. In this case, projecting onto the best possible convex relaxation actually requires polynomial time, but you still get a dramatic reduction by observing that every element of the signal set consists of the same number of ones and the same number of zeros. And so you can project onto a different object in convex geometry called the hypersimplex, and you get a dramatic reduction in runtime, again at the expense of a constant factor in the number of samples. The last example is one where we actually have more than just a constant factor increase in the number of samples, and it's motivated by sparse PCA and related problems where the signal set is basically a clique planted inside a larger graph. The clique is planted on square root of the nodes of a larger graph, and square root is an interesting scaling based on ideas from computer science. In this case, the convex hull is again hard to project onto. It requires fourth root of p many samples. Projecting onto the nuclear norm in this case requires square root p samples, so there is an increase there, but the runtime goes down dramatically. So this is one case where you have more than just a constant factor increase in the amount of data required. Okay, one question for the audience. Why is it that I could project onto an even simpler convex set than the nuclear norm ball, right? The Euclidean ball is even easier to project onto than the nuclear norm ball. The number of samples required goes from square root p to p if you want to obtain a risk one estimate. Why is it that I didn't have this third line in the previous example or the examples before that? The reason I didn't is that this is, in principle, easier to project onto. Projecting onto the Euclidean ball requires just time order p. But if you have order p samples that you need to process, what is the total runtime? It's n times p to compute the sample mean, and then order p operations to project. So you actually end up with order p squared total runtime if you were naively adding up n numbers. So the pre-processing step of even computing the sample mean is so much that this is not a reasonable thing to try to do. You're better off just taking square root p of these samples and applying the nuclear norm approach. Now, of course, this in this case, it makes sense to throw away data, and this goes back to this sort of flattening of the plot that I had right at the beginning. Now, of course, there are lots of caveats here. Adding numbers is, you know, a very efficient operation, at least if it's done in parallel, whereas the projection operation is something that needs to be done somehow more serially, if you will. And so there are lots of considerations, lots of caveats in being able to make these sorts of claims. If you want to make these claims formally, you need computational lower bounds, as was pointed out. But at least, depending on the space of algorithms that you use and the kind of computational infrastructure you have, there will be cases where it makes sense to throw away data, because trying to get to that extra data actually costs you computationally in ways that are not beneficial. Okay, one interesting question that I took away, at least from all this, is that in many, many cases, it seems that you don't need too many extra samples to be able to back off to really simple algorithms. And this is in contrast to the sorts of things you see in computer science. Some of the relaxations I used to project onto were very weak relaxations if you take the viewpoint of approximation ratio. So the approximation ratio of the relaxation relative to the original set was very bad. This is the quantity of interest if your end objective is, say, combinatorial optimization or some other problem that is typically considered, of that type, that's typically considered in computer science. If your end objective is inferential, then approximation ratio is not the quantity of interest. The quantity of interest is somehow how these Gaussian complexities scale as you use weaker and weaker relaxations. So you care geometrically. This is the sort of thing you care when you look at approximation ratio. You take the worst case linear functional and look at the gap between the relaxation and the original set. In our case, we care about, I mean, there are two differences relative to this. You care about how the corners of the set fatten rather than how most of the mass of the set behaves. So it's a more algebraic property rather than a more metric or geometric property. The second contrast to this is that in approximation ratio, typically one considers worst case gaps, if you will, between the original set and the relaxation, whereas in our setting we care about Gaussian complexity, so we somehow average guys in the cone rather than taking the worst case guy. But if you have these, if you incorporate these two differences, you get radically different performance using for statistical inference problems than for combinatorial optimization problems, because using very weak relaxations actually makes sense now, because you just need a constant factor more data relative to, say, a combinatorial optimization problem where the approximation ratio would be so bad in using these relaxations that you'd typically consider them to be not very useful. Okay, so I've talked about some challenges with massive data sets and specifically the role that massive amounts of data can play in trying to reduce computational runtime. I talked about this concretely in a very specific denoising problem, and finally talked about trade-offs via convex relaxation, using convex relaxation as a mechanism for algorithm weakening. I think there are many interesting avenues for future work, certainly going to more more interesting families of problems beyond, more interesting families of estimation problems beyond the one I talked about is of interest. Like I mentioned in the previous slide, Gaussian complexities of these hierarchies of LP or SDP approximations to convex sets is, I think, of interest relative to approximation ratios of these hierarchies. And I think it's also of interest to consider other mechanisms for weakening algorithms beyond convex relaxation, things like dimension reduction or clustering as interesting pre-processing steps to try and scale up to massive data sets while not increasing computational runtime, I think are all very reasonable things to try to do. Thank you. Basically, just in the IID assumption, I guess. I mean, at no point am I, at least in what I described, I wasn't taking a smaller sample size. I was just aggregating a larger sample size. But if, in fact, you were to subsample, at least in the setup that I talked about, the data points are IID, so there's no sense of sort of adversarial or worst case. Although, yes, in cases like that, I think something that departs from what I talked about would be of interest. That's interesting. That's an interesting question. I would think that if you have any information about your distribution, you would use that information to try to design your convex set appropriately. A reasonable thing to try to do is to try and have your convex relaxation be very tight near sort of the worst case parts of your distribution and have it be relatively weak or loose in parts that that are far away from the worst case parts, right? So,
what if you don't know what the distribution is?
Well, then I would still imagine being able to make certain claims, but I don't know if this at least what I talked about directly applies. Okay.
Thanks.